You know, a lot of people have told me that Terrence Malick, they're not quite sure of what kind of a director he is, actor's director, cerebral director, whatever. All I can say is my experience. And my experience was that he trusted me to bring what he hired me to bring. And then he trusted me even more to bring things that I didn't even know I had in me.
I had gotten the script about 3 months ago. Penny Allen had given me the script to read, and then she told me that they were looking, they couldn't find the part of the captain. So I read it. It was really about this thick. I was going, geez, you know, the hell am I gonna get through this thing? And as soon as I read it, I thought, here's a good script. It's huge. A lot of logistics trying to do this right, you know. To me, what came across was how thankless the part of the captain felt, you know? I mean, his men weren't behind him. They didn't really believe in him until something in their process happens that turns these men around. So I felt it was a pretty thankless role. You're gonna get beat up, you're gonna get fired, and then you're gonna get sent home. And so I thought, where's the joy in that, you know? So ultimately, there were enough heads who prevailed to convince me that this is an opportunity not to pass up, you know.
I originally auditioned for the part of Private Doll, which is the one that I played, and I auditioned a bunch of times.
I was doing a Sam Shepard play at the time, and then Sam Shepard did Days of Heaven with Terry, and from what I gather from Terry, Sam showed him a tape of the play, but I needed to be in this film, even if I had if I was carrying ammunition to Nick Nolte, I had to be in the films.
I actually flew down to Austin, Texas to meet Terry when I heard that they were casting for the film, because Terry didn't know who the hell I was, and I was determined that he would know who I was. And it resulted in the audition. I remember the audition process being very meticulous, very slow. Terry's very quiet, and very thoughtful. And you really got the feeling like you were invited into the inner world of a poet.
There were five pilots they wanted to sign me for, and I was going to test five pilots. And I kept coming back to the Thin Red Line. And they were saying, well, look, we'll talk to Diane Crittenden and then radio down to in Australia, because Terry's, you know, looking at locations. And so, is he going to get any part in the movie? That was it. That was a fair question. And then Terry's response, or Diane, was, Jim needs to take the work he can get at hand. And then it went on. I mean, this was like 12 weeks. And then one day, he calls me at home, and he says, "Hey Jim, this is Terry. He says, I was wondering if you, I would, and I'll never forget." He says, "I'd like you to play Wit." And he says, "Well, okay, Jim. Well, welcome aboard. And I feel like I'm getting on a train. I can't get off." And I said, "Don't worry, I'll be there." And so I knew before my agents even knew. I had to call them and tell them.
The whole prep for the film, it was literally, we were bombarded with packets, information of the film, the time, the dialect, the information of where we're gonna shoot, which was in Cairns, Port Douglas and Cairns, which is like 2.5 hours outside of Sydney, Australia. So, you know, for me, New Yorker, it's a 6-hour flight to LA, flight to Sydney, flight to Cairns, then a 2-hour drive to Port Douglas. And it was just the scope where the whole town literally was rented out for our production. It was like literally like, I think 400 or 500 people there at any given time, you know, with the extras and just the boot camp training, and it was It was, you know, probably the equivalent of doing like a modern day Ben-Hur, you know?
We had a boot camp and it was perfect. Because it definitely got us prepared to be brothers. Not to mention it was physical and we were dirty and no shower and a week in the bush and digging our own trenches and staying up half the night on lookout. I mean, it was the real deal. But, you know, when you're sleeping eight guys in a tent with each other and it was freezing at night and you had to cuddle up, you become pretty close.
And I remember trying to, in the middle of the night, not knowing my head from my feet. And it was so cold that night. Here we are in the tropics, but it was so cold. And it was pouring down rain, like showers. We were in the rainforest, and it just comes down in sheets. And I was holding Adrian Brody, and I thought it was my wife. And you could hear this, Jim, I'm not your wife. And sorry, you know, I think he probably kissed his ear or something. Maybe I even bit it, I don't know.
I knew Adrian from high school. I knew Dash from New York. So we have camaraderie that way. Then they also put on we play basketball at nighttime. So every night we'd play basketball for like 2 or 3 hours. So there was a camaraderie there and also from the boot camp. And, you know, surprisingly it was, you know, for 23, 24 year old testosterone filled boys, we surprisingly got along.
I think it was important to capture a certain mentality of the times, you know, and I don't know if all of us went, and that's a lot to do with the writing and a lot to do with Terry's sensibility and how he set us up. And but I knew that it was important that we were guys who were from the 40s.
In preparation for this role, more than anything, I just imagined what it would be like to not know where you're going and be shot at. And it was kind of as hard or as easy as that.
They gave us a list of books to read on in preparation for filming, and so yeah, we you know, and also movies, you know, we watched, you know, From Here to Eternity, and
gave me some Copeland to listen to. It was very inspiring, sort of beautiful, very American, you know, in a strange way. This is the kind of director Terry is.
Also the technical aspect, the training of learning our weapons, sleeping with our weapons, being, you know, looking out for each other, being in the trench on lookout patrol at night, making sure you're staying awake or your partner is.
Every night we'd go running, and every day we'd go running, and I would always run in the morning, and then I would go running again at night, because Terry kept saying, oh, Jim, you better, you know, have your legs behind you. I really, really need you. Have your legs be strong, because there's a lot of hills around there.
We got hills all the time. Terry and was fond of having me and Ben Chaplin chase the crane up these hills, and you know, you're constantly falling and your weapons bumping into you, whatever. I have this great picture of me, which was like how you would come home every night, with like 4 different wrapped ice bags and one on my head, and I'm just like looking like, this is my life, you know. I guess he thought that I was physically up to matching, because you have to match your distance in these sweeping shots and you cannot let up. So you have to stay like 2 feet from the lens, otherwise focus goes out of. And so I became really close to the Aquila crane, like, because I had to stay in its proximity.
You know, you're carrying M1s, real M1s, and you know, that at the time 9.5 pounds or 9 pounds 4 ounces or something like that. Some of them weighed like 15 pounds, and you have to run up a hill like 40 times. And that's just one day. Go! Because of the grass, you had no idea where your foot was going to be. There was no footing, because it could have been a hole. You know, you had grass up to your chest. And then on top of that, you had to dodge, like, the fake bodies. Or you didn't know where they would put, like, an explosive. So you had to dodge explosives and stuff like that. So it's very difficult to see.
My uniform on this movie was never washed. So every morning, you'd wake up at 4:30. It'd be freezing out. You'd drive an hour up to set, get into your trailer, and put on this tank top that smelled like a rotten ham. And they disinfected it, but they couldn't, for continuity reasons, wash it. It weighed about 20 pounds, just the tank top, and it was cold out, and this cold, wet, damp, rotten ham smelling thing. And then you put the other one on, and you're like, and then you went and you put the dirt all over your face, and then it turned into being 120 degrees out, and you sweated all day in this thing, and it just, it was literally like a whole nother weapon. Like, it was, you're wearing 40 pounds of stank, greasy ham.
The way Terry would communicate with the actors, you know, everyone assimilated the information differently than others. So it was, we would imitate some of the direction, not so much just more spoofing the manner it was delivered. You know, there was one part where there was literally a 45-second crane shot, and it was like over 2 days. And the most you can do was one setup per day, because you had to, all the explosives had to be set up, and it was like 500 guys, and the camera would swoop down, swoop down, swoop down, swoop down, and then zoom in on the character crying. So Terry goes, okay, Kirk, all right, that's gonna be you. Go ahead and start crying. I'm cracking jokes with playing chess with Woody Harrelson. And he's just like, all right, just start crying, go ahead, go. You know, it's for some people, you know, it was difficult. You know, you have to sort of like, you know, focus right away. Because on any given day, in any given hour, you didn't know what you were gonna shoot. I mean, it was very spontaneous, you know? So the lighting suited this moment, this scene, so that's what we were gonna shoot at this moment. So, you know, you had to be on your toes.
One thing that he would tell me in the beginning, but I couldn't really understand until, you know, much later, was I would tell him, we need rehearsal, we gotta rehearse. It's a bit of a running joke. And he said, Elias, your whole life has prepared you for this moment, and I'm going, all right? What does he mean by this? What does he mean by this? I soon found out that how much my own experience in life paralleled a similarity to, without the insanity of obviously the captain's responsibility, but there was a bit of a similarity in terms of coming out from nowhere, being a reservist, being almost on the fringes of, you know, so suddenly you're called upon to take up, to be a leader of men.
There was a big scene, with this big death scene, it's like 15 pages long. And so everyone was like, oh my God, who's the actor that's gonna play that? And so then Terry and Grant came up to me and they were like, so what about you playing this? And I was like, yeah, I'd rather play that scene. Because this is when you read it, it's just like, it's a beautiful scene. And one of Terry's notes in the beginning was, now, Kirk, you're on a ship, and the beach is right there, and you're calling out into the abyss, and that's what your motivation is. So it was like, gotcha, understand. But you know, but the funny thing is about that is that I did understand. You know what I mean? His directing is very poetic, you know, very just, you know, sort of like catching for, you know, like fairies and butterflies, so to speak.
I mean, for me personally, it was tough because you got to, you know, you come in with a bit of an ego that you kind of have some idea of what to do and how to play. And then when you're told to, like, could you look to your left? That's it. Now turn around to turn to your right, look up there, listen to the distant bird. You know, so you have these hands-on kind of direction. You get kind of, it feels a little humbling, but ultimately you realize that you're part of a bigger vision, you know, and you just got to surrender yourself to it, you know.
It was like a collage. It was, you get in that mode, and when we, from the beginning of it, Terry would write, "Jim, it's kind of like this. It's kind of like this," and he'd give me a paragraph, and I would go and learn it, and then it wasn't working for me, you know. And then it was like this paragraph, that paragraph, and then it's this is what it is. It's a little of that, a little of this, and pretty soon I felt like Terry wasn't my director; he was my teacher.
They're coming.
Terry had a lot of dialogue scenes and that he cut. And then he had scenes that he wrote the night before and would give it to you. So you kind of didn't know what his, you might not have known what his intention was for the day. And sometimes he would, yeah, he would say, don't say anything now. But I think people try to put him in this category of, oh, you know, it's Terry style. He likes everything to just be a reaction. And that's not true. He loves to write, and he loves to hear the dialogue.
I was, you know, more of a spectator than anything, just watching, coming in and seeing this creation. The end of the film, you know, I could feel the miles and miles of footage that were behind this cast and crew. It was visceral, you know. John Toll shot the film from dawn to dusk, nonstop, whether it was cloudy or sunny. And I asked Terry halfway through the day, you know, most directors will wait for the sun, will spend half the day waiting for the sun or the cloud or whatever it is that you need, however you establish in the film. You're shooting magic hour, pure hard sunlight, and clouds, overcast. What are you doing? And Terry said, well, you see, this way, I've got the film, I've got the scene three ways. I've got it at magic hour, full sun, or overcast. And I could cut the movie together, and I could cut as all overcast, all sunny, or all magic hour. And that way, I could put your scene anywhere I want in the film. And I was like, oh my God, you know, you, as improvisatory as you are, as deviant from the script as you've gone, you still keeping in mind the mechanics of what you're building.
Towards the end of the movie, when Terry was figuring out who he was gonna take to Guadalcanal, it was kind of like a pick me, choose me vibe. And I was really grateful to be taken there. But it was also like, okay, we're done with the hardest part. Let's go and, you know, have a little more fun and breathe. And not, since we didn't have such a big crew and we didn't have to take care of so many people, it was a little more, you know, fun and guerrilla shoot what we shoot.
I arrived at night. I was terribly jet-lagged in the Guadalcanal or Solomon Islands or wherever the hell we were. I didn't really quite know. In sort of a dreamlike atmosphere. And it seems like all the American actors had gone native. And a lot of them were wearing native outfits. And it really reminded me of Apocalypse Now, the way that characters had just gone completely off the beaten path and were enraptured in their, enrolled in their own roles, and what they were bringing to screen was spilling over into their daily lives. And you could tell right away as an actor that these people were entrenched in the characters they were playing and the time they were playing it in, and that Terry had the actors completely in his grasp. They had all of their trust was thrown into Terry. They trusted him implicitly, and they were free to be free. And that's a great feeling, you know, as an actor. It's like, oh, I can take off my backpack and my luggage and my baggage and take off my clothes and be free.
after a certain point, there was nothing on the schedule that said you're going to do this today. You just would do stuff.
That don't matter.
And there was this beautiful girl, this beautiful eyes, and you know, Terry would catch everything. I'd look over her and...
If she swims, she will sleep.
She's beautiful. And he's like, Jim, go over and just talk to her. Ask her, just ask her how the weather is. And so I just started talking, and that's in the movie.
One of the best times I had in Guadalcanal was Adrian Brody and I found, they were doing a battle of the bands, and it was like reggae bands or whatever in the Solomon Islands. And Adrian Brody and I went, and he had his little, he makes hip hop beats and I make hip hop beats. So he had his little beat making machine, and we entered Battle of the Bands and performed in front of like 1,000 Melanesians in the middle of Guadalcanal, randomly, hip hop. It was amazing. I was hired to shoot a war film. Now, I do not think it's a war film. I think it's an amazing poem about the beauty of life.
It relaxes me to know that it's not all dependent on who is in the movie. It's the story, the filmmaker is the thing for me. And somebody with a big vision, it's obvious, you know. It'll challenge you. It'll elevate your game. It'll make you bust out from bad habits that you're used to, you know, and change, you know, and he wanted your input. He welcomed your thoughts. He didn't make you feel like you weren't a part of it. You wouldn't have been there if he didn't see something in you, you know. Life before Terry Malick and life after Terry Malick.
I think that in The Thin Red Line, we go beyond Americanism or American patriotism and get down into brotherhood and the alliances we make with each other and how you're fighting for the lives of your friends, much more so than the lives of yourself or of an ideal, of an American ideal.
Look out through my eyes. Look out at the things you made.